Giving honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Lord's Son, to the men that are with me on the pulpit, of course, always, Reverend Pastor Gibson, and Minister Brown, who will eventually become Reverend Brown. God is really, really encouraging this morning, right? To the to Reverend Simon. He keeps in contact with me, and he is celebrating his daughter's 16th birthday. So they were going on a cruise to celebrate her 16th birthday. That's part of ministry. And these are times that you can never renew again. She will never be 16 again. You know, and the thoughts of her father taking the time to be with her means everything in the world. And it's a wonderful time of teaching because, men, I'm telling you, we need to take every moment that we can to make memories so that our family will know that we are the head, but we are the head because we love you so much. Not because we're the boss, but because we love you so much. And being available with the love that we have in our lives to the Lord. So, a beautiful opportunity to teach. So that's where Reverend Simon is today. Give an honor to the deacons of this church, to the deaconess, to the choir, of course. Good job. And my beautiful sister, my beautiful sister, Sister Wallace. I love your voice. God has tremendously blessed you with the talent, and it's just beautiful. To the musicians, of course, and the directors, to the ushers, to the sound people, the multimedia ministry, God bless you. To the nurses, they have been so faithful in being sure that we've been watched after. You know, sometimes the Holy Ghost can hit you and you'll hit something else, like your head falling down. You know, I mean, that has happened. It happened here at St. Joseph many, many years ago during a I think it was revived. We had a revival. This was many years ago, probably 34 years ago. And my sister Greenaway. Yeah. She was right there, and the Lord touched her heart, and she was about to shout. She fell and hit the corner of her head on the table. And the nurses were right on the spot. I mean, instantly. So she was blessed through that ordeal. So they're not just sitting up there looking pretty. They're up there on purpose, and they do their job. So God bless you. God bless you. To St. Joseph, the hospitality ministry, to friends and family of this ministry, to my family, my sons, of course, and they've been so faithful. They don't know how it blesses my heart to look and see them. So God is, I know, going to be doing a special thing in their lives for their availability and their faithfulness. And then to my wife, who is really there by my side, even though there are times she's not feeling well, but she feels the necessity to be where her husband is. And so I thank God. We do have a message this morning. We do have a word this morning from the Lord. Be ye steadfast. Simple. Be ye steadfast. Out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 through 58. And the reason that I went that far back up in the scripture, because I need for you to know that God has a purpose for us while we're here on this earth and when we are in heaven. While we are here, It is His Holy Spirit who keeps us from being destroyed, from being harmed, to keep us available. It is His Holy Spirit that steps in, that when we make the choice to be available, then it is His Holy Spirit then who quickens us and works us through the situations that God has in store for us. That's one thing that I want each of you to put into your hearts.
Yeah.
All God wants from you is your availability. To be available. Don't ever let that get past you. Yes, it does help in preparing ourselves for ministry, preparing ourselves for things that we do within the body, but that's not what God is after. Because God can take a no-sinning person, touch their spirit, and set the church on fire. He can do it. I've seen Him do it. And then God can also take someone who think they got it all, and as they say in the business, bomb out. So it is God who does all of this Himself. But what He wants from each of us is our availability. We make ourselves available. I'm telling you, God will do the rest. Isn't it strange how throughout the Bible, every single major character or person that you see God use is somebody that don't, from our estimation, need to even be involved in church business. I mean, I'm talking about criminals, murderers, adulterers, prostitutes. You know, I mean, he just reaches and finds the worst that there is. But the one thing that stands out is their availability. Even though they may, in our sense, seem not to be qualified for what God is going to be using them for, the one thing that stood out is the fact that they were available. And so God works in that same way today. You make yourself available and God will do the rest. Matter of fact, He'll make it so easy, it'll be just like someone that I heard some years ago, like a hot knife going through salt butter. I don't know who that was. But that's the easiest way to explain it. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 51. Behold, Paul writes, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or die, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible body must put on incorruption, and this mortal body must put on immortality. For when this corruptible body shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal body shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Praise the Lord. One thing we need to know as brothers and sisters, that no matter what we do, as we've been guided by the Holy Spirit, will not be in vain. simplest of the things that we do and make it monumental. Now, I don't know about you, but in my life, I've seen things that I thought was just mundane, things that were just simple, that had no real paramount importance. And God can take it, and I'm listening, and people are being, I'm talking about being strengthened, and as if that I had taken something and turned it upside down. But it was God. God will take the simplest of your efforts, of what you do when your heart and your mind is set on the kingdom, and he will make it a monumental work that are in a way you cannot even describe. And those that are listening on, all they can do is praise the Lord for what they are hearing and what they're seeing. Quit trying to be all of that. And just start making yourselves available, knowing that God will make that difference. That's all he's requiring of us, is to be steadfast in your belief and in your trust. All he wants us to do is to believe that he has done it all. To believe and to receive the statement that Jesus even made on the cross. He says, it is finished. When he says, it is finished, he didn't mean that, well, I got one other thing that EC needs to do, and then that'll take care of it. When he said to us, it is finished, he meant it is finished. And all we need to do is to believe in his finished work. That's all he's wanting for us, is to believe and receive what he's done. And he will make come alive in your life. The Bible says quicken. He will make something that's dead come alive in your life that you thought would never come about. That's how God will operate if you would just be steadfast in the belief that God has control of it all. The Corinthians were encouraged to stand firm in the apostles' teaching. Now, just so that you'll know, when we speak of the apostles' teaching, we're talking about the New Testament, but we're talking about from the book of Romans to the book of Philemon. Those are the apostles' teaching. Those are the scriptures geared and pointing toward us in the time of grace, in the church age. That's really something that I want you to kneel down in the spirit. Because as we go on in our teaching from the Bible, you'll see the importance of what we're saying. But Pastor, what about Mark? And what about Matthew? And all of those, aren't those New Testament? No, that's Old Testament. That we find in the New Testament portion of the Bible. New Testament is when God is dealing with his redeemed church. His redeemed church. Now, we're talking semantics. Is that New Testament? Yes, it's New Testament. But I'm talking about New Testament and it is pointing toward his church. Okay? That's all that I'm saying. Please don't get it twisted. Okay? Do not get it twisted. I'm trying to explain to you, if you are reading the scriptures, studying the scriptures, and you're trying to see what God has as he speaks to his church in the church age, he is speaking of from the book of Romans to the book of Philemon. Okay? That's where the mystery is. Paul constantly talks about this mystery, this mystery, this mystery. Unmoved by the lies of this world, when we study the apostles' teaching, we see what God has in store for us as we become evangelists and leading people toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? It is important for us to understand that we are people who are living in a time of grace. What does that mean? That means that God has done it all. What he's done for us, he has planted and printed on our hearts the law. Not that we must live by the law to be saved. No. What it says is that because we are children of God, because we belong to God, we have an innate, we have a desire in our heart to do those things that we know pleases God. And not to do those things that's displeasing for Him. Why? Because it is imprinted upon our hearts. Not that I've got to go out there and try to do that so that I can be saved. Jesus said that I did it all for you. I kept it all clear for you. And now that you are living in a period of grace, you must learn to depend on the power of my Holy Spirit. Depend on Him. Not on what you can do, what you can accomplish, but what He can do. Because He's all powerful. His Holy Spirit is all powerful. Three things that I want to talk about this morning. And you know, really, to believe it or not, I sort of hate sometimes to open up in a sense like that because it takes a lot of background teaching to truly understand and receive a comment like that. That the books that are pointing toward the period of grace are the books that are written by the apostles. That God has assigned to the Gentiles. It takes a lot of background and a lot of teaching on it. But I want to place that in your mind so it will start to question your heart. The one thing that I found out when I was teaching at the seminary, the best way to teach a lot of times was provoke people to think that I was going to be lying so that they would dig deeper to try to prove that I was alive, and in turn find out that the truth of the Bible is there. And that's the best way for someone to learn and to learn for themselves. Because there's a lot of stuff that we hear over time that tradition has laid down that has nothing to do with us at all. Nothing. That's one reason why so many of us get caught up in these different cults and these different religions, trying to identify ourselves with the religion that points toward our ethnicity or trying to follow a set of people that are taking a point that is totally not grounded in Scripture, but because it sounds like it ought to be right, living your life grounded by that, and missing out totally on what God is wanting us to do, and that is to believe on the finished work of Jesus Christ. On His finished work. Not what you can accomplish. Because even if you stand there and try to say this thing, well, I want the Lord to look at my life. I'm a good person. You know, I want Him to look at my good and my bad, and my good will outweigh my bad. But see, it's a part that you're not understanding. What are you going to do about the part that was bad? What about that? That's got to be dealt with. God is not going to allow sin to perpetrate itself in this world without being dealt with. So somewhere you got to consider the fact, what about my evilness? What about the unbelief that's in my life, that's in my body? Well, Jesus is taking care of all of that. So when we turn our hearts from trusting Him, we can be guaranteed that He's forgiven all of our sins, no matter what it is. Because I'm going to tell you something. If you're depending on that, you're going to mess around and be 107 years old and die with sin unforgiven. What are you going to do about that? This is serious. Especially concerning the resurrection, this provides an incentive to us for faithful service, since labor in the resurrected Lord is not in vain. Whenever you are operating under the auspices of the Holy Spirit, your work will never be in vain. Now, what is that word? What are we talking about? We're not talking about work even here towards salvation. We work because we're saved. We don't work to become saved. Because I am saved, James tells us, then you should see stuff that I do to look like Christ. If I'm claiming that I'm saved, he's not saying that I must do this work or the faith that I think I have is in vain. No, what he's saying is that because you are children of God, then as the world sees you, they should see Christ in you. And if they don't see Christ in you, then there may be an issue. And that means that you may need to return to the foot of the cross and believe to the Lord Jesus Christ for something. Because if you're a born-again believer, if you're a child of God, and you're still doing sins without any conscience about it, all I'm trying to say to you, that there may be an issue. We are all grounded on the fact, if we are children of God, that we believe and trust that Jesus has done it all. And all he is calling for us to do is to be steadfast in what he has done. Not steadfast in what you think you're doing. Well, there are three points, of course, that I want to bring to us today. One of them, the first one, is just simply to stand fast. Steadfast, stand fast. We're talking about the same thing. And what's quite interesting is that in the New Testament, standing fast is mentioned to us 46 times in the New Testament alone. It is also mentioned all through the Old Testament, but I'm just talking about in the New Testament, 46 times. And so what is it that God is trying to say to us if he's pointing out that many times for us to stand fast? It's for us to believe that he is not directing us falsely, that he is not going to cause us to fall into a ditch when we are following his instructions. And if we know that God is speaking to us and he's touching our hearts, we can stand fast in knowing that he's going to carry us to where he wants us to be. See, a lot of times we don't know that we need to be here or there. We may think that that's where we ought to be, but we don't know unless the Holy Spirit is guiding us. That's why we have to learn how to learn to listen to the voice of God. Because as new believers, the voice of God, in our opinion, may sound like our own voice. So we must learn to differentiate between the two. How do we do that? We do that through trials and errors. Whenever a situation's come in our lives and we are going to God and, God, what is this thing? You know, what is it that you want me to do? What is it that I need to learn from this? And then as we listen to that quiet voice, we start to hear a familiarity in that sound. And then as we grow from that, we start to learning this difference between the sound of his voice and the sound of your own voice, or the sound of someone else's voice, or even the sound of your pastor's voice. Your pastor ain't Jesus. Your pastor ain't God. Your pastor ain't the Holy Spirit. You need to learn how to hear his voice and how to know that he is guiding you and how he is speaking to you. And once that becomes a part of your life, once that becomes a part of what you do in your secret closet and learning how to hear his voice, then you're set on the path to know that when you hear him, stand fast, because he's going to carry you where he wants you to be. You know, even in our human lives, we learn to, after a while, be able to hear our wife's voice. We can tell the difference. You know, you get to a point where you won't even, you can't even be fooled about your spouse's voice. I mean, you learn that voice so well until just a grunt from it, you know, oh, that's dear. You know, you can learn to tell. And your children especially.
Yeah.
When you have babies in the house, when they, you know your baby's voice when they cry out compared to some other baby's voice. You know the difference. Why? Because you have, you know, instinctively learned to listen. You've learned to just tell the difference between them. Well, the same thing with God.
Yeah.
You're not ready to be functional in this kingdom walk until you are able to understand when you hear the voice of your Savior. Even when little Samuel was learning and so forth, and Jesus or God would be calling him, and he would run because he thought it was Eli that was calling him. You know, and Eli would say, "No, baby, I haven't called you. Go back to sleep." And the Lord would call him again, and he'd jump up and he'd run to the old priest. The priest would say, "It's not me." And it happened two or three times, and then finally, the priest told him, says, "Look, the next time that you hear that, just answer, 'Here am I, Lord, here am I.'" Just simply, "Here am I." The same thing that we're saying today. Here am I. I don't know what you want, Lord. I don't even know what the qualifications of what you want me to do. But I am available. And I'm available to stand fast in what you have for me to do. Learn his voice. Trust his voice. And when you have done that, then you learn to stand fast in what he is trying to get you to do. This world will fool you. This world will trick you. And when you learn to stand fast, you become immovable. You become like a stone statue in the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing can deter you. Nothing can move you out of the way. And when that becomes a part of your life, then you truly become an instrument that God can use. Why? Because no matter how Satan tries to attack it, you know the voice of your Savior. You know the voice of your Savior. The Bible says that Satan is so good at what he does, he can present himself as ministers of light. And he can present himself so what is the word?
Vivid.
Okay, yeah, so whatever. Until the Bible says that if it were not for the fact of God cutting the time short, and even the very elect. And when God uses that, he's trying to let you see, he's talking about truly somebody that who is saved without question. That the very elect would be fooled behind it. And that's why it's so important for us to learn the voice of our Savior. Lesson number one in learning that. Go in your secret closet and be afraid. Situation has come in your life. Lord, there's a situation. What shall I do? And listen. And pay attention to what you do. When you follow that voice and it winds up being the right way to go on the end result, you finally say, "Well, when I hear it that way, I know that's the voice of Jesus." That's just a simple way of learning to understand and hear and receive the voice of your Savior. But when you do that, then you learn that you can be steadfast. Because he will not ever deceive you. The second thing, always abounding. That's in our scripture. We're talking about the last verse in our scripture, that second verse number 58. It says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast and unmovable, always abounding." Always abounding. In other words, you're nourishing, you're growing. In the truth of God. As you hear him, as you learn him, and as you follow him, you're growing. You're getting stronger and stronger and stronger. You're flourishing. like a flower that you have placed nutrients to, fertilizers and other things that it may need, as you are constantly feeding it. And when we speak of it that way, we're talking about hearing the word of God, reading the word of God, learning what his promises are, and then living by his promises. You will find yourself flourishing and abounding and growing more and more like what he is wanting for you in your life. You will become more and more like Jesus Christ himself. When you're reading his word, when you allow his word to come alive in your life, when you're doing that, you'll find yourself becoming more and more and more like Jesus Christ. And that's a wonderful thing. But be cautious and be knowledgeable to the fact that the more that you do that, the more that Satan is going to send his imps in your direction. He's going to try his best to put his foot out in front of you and trip you up and laugh at you when you follow those instructions and fall. Satan has a tendency to where he just wants God to be embarrassed at everything that he does. That's what he wants. But Jesus says that as you learn my voice, as you learn to hear my voice and my voice only, then you will learn how to abound. You will learn how to be strengthened. In John chapter 10, round about verse 10, 9, 10, 11, it talks about how God has set it to where you will hear only one voice. You will learn to recognize that one voice, and you will follow that one voice. And he's speaking up there, he's giving a parable, but he's speaking about himself. That when you start to hear his voice, you will learn to follow only his voice. There's an illustration that I used to use in the seminary, in teaching in that area. There was a video that I had, and I would play it. But it showed the shepherds as they would come in the evening from their places where they had their sheep all out grazing. They would all come in, and then they would all come together for the night. There would be probably about 7 or 8 different flocks. But at the night time, they would all come together. They would huddle up against each other, you know, during the night to where they would be protected. But the beautiful part, the beautiful thing, the next morning, early in the morning, just when the sun is rising, it showed the shepherds, they would go, they had a specific place that they would stand, like on a rock, to where the sheep and everybody else could see them. And one at a time, they would go out, and they would stand, and they would make a specific call that they used, a specific vocal expression they would make. And the most beautiful thing, you started seeing the sheep rustling. They started like moving around. But what you will find out is that the sheep that would hear the voice of that shepherd would come to where he was and surround him. And the next shepherd would stand, and he would do the same thing and the same process. The sheep that was of his fold would come and stand around him. And they would all do that until all the shepherds would have their flocks. And all they would do was stand and vocally call out to them. They knew the sound of their shepherd's voice. And no other shepherd that they followed, even though there were 6 or 7 or 8 other shepherds there, none of them would wind up in there. And even when one of the baby lambs would try to go toward a flock that was not theirs, one of the older sheep you would see go and nudge them back into the correct fold that they should be in. And then when they were all gathered together, then the shepherd would come down off that rock, and he would lead them to pasture. They would eat and nourish themselves as he would watch over them. The most beautiful sight you've ever seen. But the point that was being made was that the sheep would hear only the voice they would only respond to the voice of their shepherd. No other voice will they hear or follow, but of the voice of the shepherd. That was the shepherd of their fold. And that's where Jesus wants us. He wants us to, over time, as we hear his voice in our hearts, as we're in our secret closets, and we're hearing him, to learn the sound of his voice. So when he speaks to us, we will immediately know that it's he who is talking to us, and not the enemy. And then the last point that I want to bring is, what do you do that will count for Jesus? What you do that will count for Jesus? Our work for the Lord, you must know already, is not in vain. Whatever that you are working in the kingdom's work, and what I mean about that is just the simplest of anything, just at a bus stop, telling somebody about the power of the risen Savior, Jesus Christ, can lead someone, whether they do it then or later, into their hearts of wanting to know this Savior. See, there are people that are dying every single day, and they never hear the power that is in the salvation. We talk about the gospel, but what is the gospel? And you'll find the gospel clearly in that same chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1, 2, and 3. And Paul is simply saying in there is that according to the scriptures, Jesus Christ died on the cross and was buried. And according to the scriptures, he was raised again, bodily and alive. That's the gospel. And Paul goes on in Romans chapter 1, tells us that is the power of the salvation. There is no other way that salvation can be given but by the risen Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us on Calvary for the very purpose of strengthening us so that we can stand fast and be steadfast in this world system today. There are attacks that come from every direction. They're attacking our children. They're causing them to be way past what we expected them to be and thinking nothing of it. But God will not allow that to happen if we stay spiritually on our knees and steadfast and trusting in him. He is able. He knows the enemy. We don't know the enemy. We can't even see him when he's attacking. But he knows it. And he wants us to be able to learn the sound of his voice so we will follow only his voice. And when we hear it, then he wants us to be steadfast, unmovable, abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that everything that we do is for the kingdom's benefit. Our word will speak for us as a leader seek, be knowing on that. We find that also in 1st and 2nd Corinthians. That we must stand at the beaver seat or the judgment seat of Christ, not for the purpose of salvation, but for what we have done in our flesh. We're going to have to give an account when the Lord sends somebody across our path to let them know that there is a risen Savior that has died for your sins, and you refuse to respond. You're going to have to give an account of that one day. You're going to have to tell the Lord why you didn't respond, and it will, your reward will depend on that. The Bible tells us that us as believers, we've done all that we can do to stand. He tells us what? To stand. When you've done everything that you can do to stand, and you can't think of nothing else, the Bible tells us just stand. Knowing that he is going to make a difference. There is nothing that you can do on the other side of what he has instructed you to do. When you have come to the end of your rope, when you think that there's nothing else that I can do, I'm just going to Bible tells us that when we've done all that we can do, stand. And then when we look for step two, he said, stand. Step three, stand. Step four, stand. No matter how you come about, he said, just stand. Because when I'm ready, you will see me make difference. And I'm going to always move when I'm ready. Because he's got others that are watching on. He said that. Stand when there's no other reason to stand. Just stand in the room. And guess what? Just stand. He's never going to leave us. He's never going to forsake us. He's never going to have us be embarrassed in the kingdom. That is not what God has in mind. But when we stand on his word, when we stand on what we know he has called us to do, God says that when he's ready, I will come about and I will make a difference. Just stand. Don't give it up. Don't walk away, just stand. Don't just ball up in a knot and start crying, just stand. And Jesus, I'm telling you, he won't hear. Oh, he won't hear. Oh, yes, he will. He won't hear. In his glory, he won't hear. Just stand. Just stand. Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus made that point clear. Even though the world was against him, even though all of humanity didn't like what he was bringing about, Jesus stood in the word of his Father. The Bible tells us that he made no moves until he had heard from the Father. And then when he made the move, he did it by direction and strength of the Holy Spirit. Jesus says that he never did anything under his own volition. And the reason why is because he wanted us to be able to identify with him. If Jesus would be working under his own power, we could have easily given an excuse. Well, I can't do it like Jesus, because Jesus did it because he was God. No, he was 100% man and he was 100% God. But he chose to not pull upon his own deer. He did that for us so that we could see that by the Holy Spirit, we could be the same as him. Here's something to put in your mind. The Bible says to us, and I can't think right now what the scripture is, I can look it up for you, but the scripture says that the same Holy Spirit that raised him from the dead is the same Holy Spirit that lives in us. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. The same Holy Spirit that raised him from the dead is the same Holy Spirit that he's telling us to stand fast on. That when he speaks to us and gives us instructions, what are we to do? Stand. But the world didn't believe him, so they decided to kill him. Not knowing that they didn't decide, that God had decided that ahead of time. He sent his son into the world to die for mankind and for everything else that had been taken. And he accomplished it. He accomplished it. He lived and did not sin, to show us that he was capable to live under the law righteously. Yes. So that he could give us that finished work. Yes. We must be able to live under the law, not because we were able to, but because he did it for us. Yes. And by that, we are justified. Yes. But he went to the cross. He did. He went to Calvary's cross and he was nailed to that old rugged cross in our stead. He was lifted up so the world could see what they had done to the Son of God. The whole world could see the horrible way they had disfigured the Son of God. The Bible says he was not even distinguishable. Look at Psalms. Psalms 122 and a bunch of them. But they had beaten him so badly. Flesh had been torn away from him so badly, even on his face. Everything. Until he was not even recognizable. But here this torn up mass of flesh was nailed to this cross because of us. On that cross, the Bible said that he had completed everything that the Father had sent him to do. And knowing that that had been completed, the Bible says he died. He gave up the ghost. And when he died, they took him off the cross and they put him in a large tomb to where his body laid, all mangled and torn apart. For 3 days and 3 nights. Now he was in the heart of the earth. He was in hell itself, paying the penalty that we should have been paying. But he was there preaching to those that were in Abraham's bosom, because at that time they could not go into paradise, those that were saved, because Jesus had to do it first. So they were held in what was called Abraham's bosom, which was across the gulf from where hell was. And the Bible says he also went into hell, into the uttermost part of the earth, where there he preached to the lost, telling them, I'm the one that you killed the prophets over. Truly, I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. And then, when he had done all that he had been sent to do by the Father, he took all of those that were in Abraham's bosom, all of the Old Testament saints, all those who were saved, gathered them up and took them into paradise. And the Bible says once he done that, then hell was enlarged. Hell was enlarged. What does that say? That there's plenty of room for those who reject Jesus. If you reject the Lord Jesus Christ, God renovated hell over 2,000 years ago to accommodate you. But everything was done as the Father had assigned him to do. And when that was completed, the Bible says that God kissed his Son way before nature itself had a chance to even do her thing, while there was dew on the roses, as we can sing about, while there was no quickening of life so early in the morning. God kissed his Son and woke him from the dead. Raised him bodily and alive. And God has called him back to heaven. There he sits on the right hand of the Father, still interceding for us. Still telling the Father that when we sin, I paid the cost. My blood covers that sin. Yes, but the end of the gospel, yes, sir, is that he's coming again, yes, for his church. Yes, tell him, say, there ain't no preaching until the gospel has been preached. All the other stuff is for, for teaching and for adoration and for everything else, but until the gospel has been preached, there has been no preaching. Because God says the power unto salvation is through that gospel. Yes, sir. That gospel has been preached. Yes, sir. And if you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, then the blood is off of me, because I presented that gospel to you. Yes, sir. I pray now that if you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, if you don't know him, this is the opportunity for you to come and receive him unto yourself. As we stand. As we stand. Don't let this message go like a demon. No, please don't. If there's anyone here today that's not sure of whether you're saved or not, why don't you come? Why don't you come? Let there be no doubt in your heart. Because there's going to be a day when there's not going to be a second chance. Jesus is either going to say to you, depart from me, I never knew you. Or he's going to say, servant, well done. Come unto me. Which statement is going to be presented to you?
Growth comes by studying God's word. And when all hell is breaking loose in our life, he just tell us to abound and stay and learn about you even more. So we thank you. I pray and God that you will bless the offering that we're about to receive, that it may be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom, and in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
On Friday evening at 6 p.m., the program will begin. But But there is a registration. All you brothers, registration begins at 5:30 to 6. So you register, come early, 5:30. Service should begin at 6. But guess what? You're going to be served in. Praise God. You hear the word, you come together in the brotherhood, and you get served in. Sounds like a plan. Ooh, thank you, Lord, for the provisions. Volunteers are needed to help serve in this event. St. Joseph, you do an amazing job. To God be the glory. We come together. So let's continue to come together for this. If you're interested in volunteering, let's see, come see Sister Dulcet Campbell. Sister Campbell, raise your hand. Throw your hands up just in case. Y'all will see this pretty young lady right here. She will direct you in the volunteer. Yes, Sister Campbell. Sister Campbell is most definitely our head of culinary. This is Sister Campbell. Carolyn, throw your hands up. She is head of the culinary, just in case you didn't know. She does an amazing job.
Amen.
But we're going to take some pressure off a little bit, baby. See Sister Dulcet Campbell. Okay, yes, sir. Also, but on the 25th, that very next day, Saturday, the auxiliary, the Brotherhood continues, the convention continues. At 7 a.m., men show up. There's breakfast served for you. Okay, so to God be the glory, that 7 a.m. on that Saturday, May the 25th. And, of course, volunteers are needed for that one as well, so the same box. The Brotherhood asks that you wear their colors. The colors are black and gold or black and yellow. If you are planning on attending, if you could wear the colors, that would be a nice united front. To God be the glory on that, okay? All right, and if you have any other additional questions in reference to the convention, see the leader, Brother Al. Throw your hands up, Brother Al. Yeah, see him for all in detail questions. All right, so to God be the glory on that. All right, so let's not forget our weekly ministries as on the back of our programs, but they are very, very important. Our Wednesday night Bible study, whoops, Wednesday has the SOS girls, and our Friday night rocks with our youth. So let's not forget those. District 2, where you at, District 2? District 2 is meeting this afternoon after church service in the fellowship hall for your district meeting. So all District 2 members, okay? The 6th annual Pretty Hat Tea Scholarship event. This is from Divine Divas of Jacksonville. We all have heard of this wonderful organization. Our very own Sister Smith is a part of this. But it is a scholarship, high school and college. So let me read a little. The Divine Divas of Jacksonville are proud to present a scholarship to a deserving high school senior and a college sophomore or junior. There are some criteria to meet, but it is an essay required, and it is due by June the 21st of this year. There is a contact number to submit your essay to. The number is 904-993-0899, but if all else failed in this message that I just gave you, it is on the board. Please see it. It is on the board. So all high school seniors and college juniors and sophomores. Praise God. Scholarship. That's right. Amen. All right, church and pastor anniversary. The month of June is coming up. Okay? On the second week is June the 9th. On that morning and evening, we will celebrate, okay? On the third week, which is June the 16th, only in the morning. We will do. We will celebrate only in the morning. We will not return, but we also celebrate with a dinner, a Father's Day dinner. Ain't that a blessing? Yes, Lord. And of course, on fourth Sunday, morning and evening, that's June the 23rd, we will be celebrating the anniversary. There's five Sundays in the month of June. We will not be celebrating the anniversary on the fifth Sunday of this June. So, also on the first Sunday night and the fourth night, fourth Sunday night is June 20. So it's June 2nd and June 23rd, the night, the evening services. We're asking specifically if you would wear our colors. The color of this year's theme is black, white, and red. However you want to mix it up, make it all pretty. We are asking to specifically wear on those nights if it's available. But let's not forget it, the fourth night, fourth Sunday, which is June 23rd, that evening is our pastor's night. Oh, bless his holy name. That is the night that we come, show extra love to our pastor and his beautiful, wonderful, sweet first wife. We ask that you prepare ourselves accordingly, okay, for that. So all members are asked to wear the specific colors on the first and fourth Sunday night. All right, so black, white, and red. Okay?
Amen.
I beat that dead horse, didn't I? Yes, Lord. All right, as we go forward, St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church, Father's Day and Appreciation Dinner, again, I said June 16th, immediately after morning worship in the cafeteria and the fellowship hall. Okay? St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church, please join Pastor Gregory and the anniversary committee for a Father's Day celebration and appreciation dinner. Also, please feel free to bring your father or your son, who is a father, to church with you for the celebration. Praise God. Please know this dinner is for all members of St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church. However, to ensure that we are able to plan properly, all attending must sign up no later than the second Sunday, that's June the 9th. Please do. There is a sign-up sheet that is already posted on the board. You'll see the flyer, and right up under it, we'll have the sign-up sheet. It is very imperative that we all sign up best we can so that we can prepare accordingly. And so please do so. I look forward to serving and eating with you all again. Last year was an amazing blessing. It's awesome. So thank you very much for the announcement. I believe that does conclude me for today. Thank you. God bless you.
June 20th, 2024.
journey, the mission trip promises to be a life-changing experience to our youth, offering them the chance to completely involve themselves in service, culture, and spiritual growth. They will lodge at the Bible College in St. Thomas, Virgin Island, and will fellowship with youth at Longa Bay. This mission trip is a monumental step toward personal development and deeper connection to loving God, loving man, and loving the fellowship. We need your support to make this a memorable experience. Your prayer and financial generosity will empower our youth to spread light and hope in ways they never imagined. You may donate to BlackBottom by giving your donation to Deacon Jones, scan the QR code, or drop your donation in the mission box that will be placed in the vestibule. Every bit counts. No donation is too small when it comes to making this mission trip a reality. Please and thank you so much for your support. There is a flyer that will be placed out and on the bulletin board, and the QR code is there. Thank you so much. $5,000. This will cover air flight, the lodging. Okay, we're trying to raise $5,000. This will cover airfare, the lodging, the food, and we want to take the kids on excursions. And for some of you who have traveled, Sister Sarah Hawkins mentioned to me last week, a gallon of milk costs $12, and the kids will be there a week, so we need your support. Thank you.
Amen. Bye.